Welcome to another episode, a special episode of the Big J and Little J Show, where this is our first YouTube episode. I think it's episode 48, Connor, via podcast, but I think this will be episode, there is an old episode from season one on my YouTube channel, but I will probably take that off because we have upgraded, Connor, to StreamYard. So welcome to new viewers. This is the Big J and Little J Show, where we discuss Duke athletics, Duke basketball, and Duke football. And we today will be recapping the Virginia Tech win last night, and we'll preview later the Duke UNC game this weekend. But first, Connor, Duke won 77-67 in Blacksburg. Duke was 1-6 in their previous 1-5 in the previous six matchups in Blacksburg, and a solid win for the program, Connor. It was the first time since 2019-2020 that Duke won at Virginia Tech.
Yeah, I was up there. It was trying to think of a way to say this in a column that'll come out on Devils Illustrated later in the week. It was Duke's 20th game, and I think it's the first one that I went into thinking they were going to lose. Like, I was more convinced, I was at least more convinced they were going to lose that game than any of the previous 19. Like, the Arizona game I thought was a toss-up. It was so early in the season. The Arkansas game, you knew they were walking into a buzzsaw, but Arkansas was coming off a terrible performance in whatever MTE they were in. I think they're in the Bahamas. Nobody saw Georgia Tech coming. We should have seen Pitt coming. Like, I think we talked about that last week. All the factors that we kind of pushed to the side in that one with the Capels emotionality. I should be able to come up with a better word than that, but the emotions of the Capels when they come to Tobacco Road should have tipped us off there. I don't know about you. I thought they were losing last night by the score that they wound up winning by. Like, I thought it was easy money for anybody that was going to bet Virginia Tech.
Yeah. No, if you would have, like, when the schedule came out, this was one of the games where it's like, hey, you're just going to have to face – it's at Virginia Tech and at NC State every year where I'm like, this is going to be a tough test for Duke, no matter if they're 0-4 in the conference. They're going to give Duke a run for their money at Virginia Tech or in PNC.
And it's a Saturday, Monday. Like, it's the second half of a two games in 3 days. And that's just so hard. And one of the things that we didn't, you know, I'm not going to get into the details of a post-game presser. I wish we had talked a little more to John and the players last night about what makes Virginia Tech such a difficult scout on short rest. Because as we've seen last year, when they played up in Blacksburg, it was a Saturday, Monday, and Virginia Tech ran everything in their offense to perfection. Like, Hunter Couture got 5 threes. Can't remember who else burned them up there. I feel like it was pretty even spread. I just remember Couture because he was coming off of the 7 3-pointers the previous year in the ACC championship game. But, and then the ACC championship game, obviously, that's a even shorter rest. And Virginia Tech blew through Duke, really felt like they shot about 70% in that game.
Yeah, they win by the three and die by the three, for sure.
They do. And it's another discussion that we probably don't have time for to talk about how Mike Young winds up with a team with so few shooters. I'm kind of shocked that he has two centers rumbling out there and bumbling, and you can stand 10 feet away from them when they're at the top of the key and not worry about it. But no, it was a complete performance from Duke. There's no other way to put it. One of the other most impressive things about it to me, Virginia Tech isn't the best rebounding team. It's not like they, you know, Duke is going to play a lot better of a rebounding team on Saturday. Let's put it that way. We know that. But Duke got out-rebounded by 9 by Clemson. And Clemson was so much tougher on the boards than they were, so much more physical. Duke had a 27-rebound spin going plus 18 against Virginia Tech. And a lot of times those second chance points were exactly what Duke needed. The most important ones were the three at the end of half, where Jeremy Roach gets a wing three, it misses. Sean Stewart gets the rebound and kind of tips it to Flip, and Flip gets it back to Roach, who shoots over Robbie Barron and gives him a little bit of an ass pat on his way by when the ball goes in. I mean, John called it the most important play of the game. Flip called it one of the most important plays of the game. Roach didn't quite go that far, but he knew what he did. He knew how important that was, especially because the end of halves, you know, we've gone from talking about Duke's slow starts to now talking about they start games well and they play well in the first halves. And then in the last three to four minutes of first halves, they kind of let everything get away from them and go into halftime feeling a little sorry for themselves.
Yeah, I mean, that was my X factor for the game. I was on Locked On Blue Devils yesterday, and that was my thing was, look, this Virginia Tech team, their leading rebounder came in averaging 6.5 rebounds. This is a team you have to take advantage of on the glass, and on the road, a recipe for success is stealing possessions on the offensive glass. And Ryan Young did that. Duke had 10 offensive rebounds, and Virginia Tech as a team had 20 total rebounds. So when you have half of a team's total rebounds, that's a winning recipe for Duke and a losing recipe for Virginia Tech. I mean, they turned the ball over only 4 times. Like, if you turn the ball over less than 5 times in a game, you win that 8 out of 10 times. But Duke just continues to win games, Connor, in different variations, like different ways. They're out-rebounded against Clemson, but they still found a way. They out-rebound Virginia Tech and don't turn them over, but they still found a way.
Yeah, they lost turnovers by 10 last night.
Yeah, when you have 14 turnovers on the road, that's a recipe for disaster. So it's just like that's where box scores are just – it's crazy.
That's a season high for Duke. I wouldn't expect 14 turnovers in many games based on the way they take care of the ball normally. And I did the math. I don't know if they were quite at 14 yet, but I did the math during the game. And at one point, it was like 5 out of 12 Duke turnovers were on offensive fouls. So – yeah, those are turnovers. They're also turnovers that aren't giving your opponent a fast break. They're taking the ball out on their end of the court. There's a difference when you talk to coaches and when you talk to players. The live ball turnovers are the ones that kill you.
Yeah, the dead ball is gone.
They will kill you against North Carolina. I keep wanting to jump us ahead, and we're not there yet. But Duke has done a great job of limiting live ball turnovers. And part of that is as simple as you have play 3 guards at a time, sometimes 4 guards. They're going to take care of the ball a little better than when you have Mark Mitchell at the 3, Flip at the 4, and a 5 in there, like we saw last year. So, yeah, it's turnovers was a weird stat last night. Rebounding mattered so much. 9 for 17 on threes mattered so much. And when you dove into the threes, early, one of the things that stood out to me, you know, when you drive back from one of these places for 2 hours, you have a lot of time to spend rehashing the game in your head. And there was a sequence in each half where Duke hit 3 threes in less than 3 minutes. So it wasn't just this constant drip of 3-pointers that Duke was pouring in. It was they were hitting them with a sledgehammer, basically, is the way I think of little sprints like that. And that really took the crowd out of the game. Like, I've been up to Blacksburg now 3 times for games, and last night was the most muted atmosphere I've seen it. And that's because Duke kind of beat Virginia Tech at its own game with the 3-pointers. You're able to shoot that efficiently, and fans are going to sit on their hands and wonder, why can't we make those shots?
Yeah, poor guy got there, what, at like 12 p.m. the day before and just sat there the whole time and just watched a loss. That's a tough way to have a day right there. But to go off,
was they feature some student there?
Yeah, it was like the early – he was the first guy in line for the game. I think it was 12 p.m. the day before. I could be wrong. I'm pretty sure that's what it was. But I was going to go off of that, Connor, about Duke's hot shooting. I mean, 55% from the field, 53% from three. But what's even crazier to me, because we keep talking about these box score stats that are crazy, Duke having 14 turnovers and out-rebounding by 18. But one to me that's crazy individually is Jared McCain's the best shooter for Duke. He was 3 of 10 from the field and 1 of 6 from 3, and Duke shot over 50% from the field and 3. And I know I talked about it last episode about the home and away splits, and if you're just tuning in for the first time, Jared McCain, I think, shoots about 49% at home from 3. Now he shoots about 23%. From 3 on the road. And this past week, Duke was 2-0 going into the Carolina game this weekend. against Clemson at home, he had 21 points, 8 of 12 from the field, 67%, and then 43% from three. And then against Virginia Tech, like I just said, 3 of 10, 1 of 6. So it's just – it's crazy. Maybe he needs to just stay and miss the bus and get shots up on away games, Connor.
This is where I make another joke about the Jared McCain an hour after the game, still in uniform, shooting in Cameron, which he does after every single home game with TJ Power.
Yep. I mean, it works clearly because the his home stats back it up.
Yeah. I guess if you're a Duke fan, you're hoping that he saved up all his road threes for Saturday.
Yeah. Geez, that would be great. That would be great. But I also want to go in, Connor, to give Ryan Young his dues, a.k.a. the pod god. 15 minutes, 10 points, 5 rebounds, 3 of those offensive, like we've talked about, 2 assists, and a great block. That block, I was like, I did not know you could jump over a piece of paper, Ryan. I mean, he had a dunk and a block. Like, those knees, he stretched before the game, Connor, and he was second on the team in plus-minus. You know I'm big in the plus-minus on it when it goes in my favor at plus 10. And the leader of the plus-minus, Connor, was Jeremy Roach with plus 12. And I want to say this on that. I don't know the last time I've ever seen a plus-minus, like the best plus-minus has come off the bench in a win. Normally the best plus-minus happens when the team loses by 30 off the bench because you got the bench guys coming in just shooting and being like plus 6 in a 30-point loss. So to see the plus-minuses be Jeremy Roach and Ryan Young off the bench, again, just a great all-around team win for Duke.
You'll have to forgive the dog here. He's a big Ryan Young fan, so he wants to make sure he gets his due.
Well, he's a dog just like Ryan Young, so it makes sense.
No, we've talked about this. Like, Ryan Young has his games where he can be effective. I thought he would be more effective against Clemson than he was. Mm-hmm. I do get a kick out. That's why I tweeted. I get a kick out of every time that he gets a block because he has 7 in the last 7 games. And he has a stretch there where he had like 4 or 5 games in a row with at least 1 and a couple of those with 2.
And he has 2 dunks in 20 games. So it's just hilarious.
I know he's an easy target, and I know it's easy for Duke fans to look at him and think, why don't we have an actual rim protector at center to play flip at the 4 more? And man, he just is who he is. Like, I don't think there's anybody on Duke's roster who's more comfortable with their role than Ryan Young is, coming off the bench, knowing where to pick his spots. I haven't gotten any inkling that he's complained about his minutes this year. It's not like he's a guy looking to get an NBA contract and play professional basketball for 15 years. Like, he knows who he is. He knows he's an under-the-rim center. And last night, he used that to his advantage. Like, Malijah Petit is going up to the rim, not thinking that he's going to get blocked from behind by Ryan Young. He knows that Ryan Young is back there, and that's why he's going up and cocking it back like he did. Ryan Young, like, he had, was it 2 layups that he used the basket as a defender? Like,
Mike and drill, baby. Mike,
run a Mike and drill and make a reverse layup. One of them I thought he made more difficult than it needed to be. I thought he could have just caught up with the left instead of doing a reverse, but hey, whatever works.
What I love about his game, Connor, is he is the textbook definition for a high school coach. Like, this is how you get offensive rebounds and rebound. You hit him in the chest, you turn, you move him out of the way. Because him and Sean Stewart, I tweeted it, and I stand by it. They're 2 of the better offensive rebounders on the team coming off the bench. And one has freakish athleticism in Sean Stewart. And the other is Ryan Young, who just positions himself so well. And he plays below the rim, but he gets offensive boards and defensive boards because he knows how to just use it as a talent. Like, it's insane. And I love him for it. Like you said, he knows his role. And that's why I've been a Ryan Young stan since last year. Like, he's easy to poke fun at, like you said, because Duke doesn't have below the rim 4s or 5 players. Like, they have guys that jump out of the gym. And if they can't jump out of the gym, they shoot the 3 like TJ Power and Filipowski. Ryan Young does not. And he's an old fashioned 1950s, 60s NBA player and just goes, plays the mic and drill. And I love him for it.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, like, even he's fresh in my mind because he was at the game on Saturday against Clemson. But even like Marshall Plumlee, I remember getting rim runs and dunks when he'd come in and spell Jahlil Okafor for a few minutes a game in 2015. Like, yeah, Duke doesn't have many guys like Ryan Young. I don't know if they'll have another guy like Ryan Young after this year. Like his eligibility's up, and you know, I don't know that anybody's going to mistake Cooper Flagg's game for Ryan Young's.
I don't know the next time Duke will have a Ryan Young. Like he is a unicorn in Duke basketball and what this one and done era has become. Like in maybe like 2006, 2007, like the Paulus team, he would have fit right in for the stereotypes, but not the 2024, not from post Zion to now, basically. Yeah. But I want to touch base, Connor, on – I talked about Roach just briefly, but he seemed healthier against Virginia Tech because Clemson, he did play, but he was, I think, 1-6 or something like that from the floor. And you could tell, like, he's still coming off the injury of his knee or ankle. And I'm sure that he's living in the ice bath in the training room for this whole week because not only three games, but three high-caliber games this week with Clemson at Virginia Tech and now at UNC. What were your thoughts on his performance?
Shire even told us that he hasn't practiced in a week and a half. So he is breaking in half John's rule of you have to, I'm not sure if it's John's rule. Don't quote me on that, but we always hear it from John. Maybe it's from the medical people, but we always hear that a Duke player has to play 5-on-5 in practice before they can play in a game. We've had so many of these that we've had to check on over the last, even just the last 2 years with John as the coach, you know, Derek Whitehead, Derek Lively, Jeremy Roach last year with the toe, Tyrese Proctor with the ankle in December. There are a lot. Jeremy Roach has not done that. Like he has not been practicing at all.
He's Seth Curry this year.
Yeah, he is not a practicing player right now, but I tend to think when it's your fourth year in the program, John hit hard on these notes last year about he and Jeremy have just been through so much together. Like it's easy to forget Jeremy came in with DJ Stewart as a freshman when nobody could come to games and then had role fluctuation with the Paolo team that went to the Final Four and caught fire and carried Duke to some NCAA tournament wins back in 2022. Got hot and was great in the ACC tournament last year when Duke won it. I think when a player has built up that kind of trust with his coaches, I mean, it's as simple as that. Like he's going to have a little more benefit of the doubt with knowing his body and knowing how much he can push himself compared to if Tyrese Proctor is going through the same thing, if Jared McCain's going through the same thing, that kind of thing. So, you know, maybe there's some double standard type stuff in there, but it's also it's trust and feel. And it's knowing that a player who's been in college basketball for 4 years, who's been in the ACC for 4 years, is going to know the limits of what he can and can't do.
Yeah. I mean, he's a senior, like you said. I mean, he has senior like royalties basically of like, hey,
seniority.
Yes, seniority. He gets benefit of the doubt. Just like I said, Seth Curry, people that's not aware, Seth Curry's last year at Duke, his shin splints were so bad, he didn't practice. He just basically played in games and averaged 18 points per game and shot like 50% from three. Like he was unbelievable. And yeah, with Roach,
I'd forgotten that. Was that 2013, the year after Austin Rivers?
Yes. So, yeah. He's honestly one of the most underrated scorers for Duke. Like, in terms of a singular season,
yeah, and
that season was special with him. But with Roach, his career so far, like we're going to look back, whatever this happens in the season happens. So I'm not going to say what happens this season, but with him, his first year, like you said, was COVID 2020. That was the most disappointing Duke team since the 94 team in terms of win losses. They would have missed the NCAA tournament. They were 500, right above 500 when the season canceled. Coach K was like, hey, there's something called COVID. Let's cancel the season because he knew, hey, his guys weren't going to be in March anyway. So he was the first to get ahead of that. Shout out to
Coach. You're confusing the years. That was 2020 at the ACC tournament. 21 was the year they were 500.
Well, and then you're correct.
Got COVID tested out of the ACC tournament after a win.
You're correct. You're correct. But his freshman year, though, was the season where they – was it – or sophomore year where they struggled? DJ Stewart.
No, freshman year.
Okay. Yeah. So basically what I was going at is
– when Jalen Johnson year.
Yeah. When they first started at Duke, it was the most forgettable Duke team in a long time.
I
still see, like, Jamin Brakefield for Ole Miss. I forget he was on the team. Henry Coleman, Texas A&M. Like, my point being, you started there as a freshman, and then – he played in a Final Four, and then last season he plays in the – he wins the ACC. And so what is the ceiling for this season where you look back, like, this is a four-year guy that appeared in the Final Four and made big shots to get to the Final Four, won the ACC. Can Duke win the regular season ACC? Like, obviously you have to beat UNC, who looks unstoppable right now. But if you don't – if you win the ACC again in the ACC tournament, that's – that's an impressive resume he's built in 4 years at Duke, considering where he started after year one. And so he's just an easy guy to pull for, too. And I know this UNC game that we're about to go into with him and RJ Davis is going to be high-caliber guard play.
The other part of it I would add on, Roach, and this is from the inside baseball of the inside the locker room and the our relationship as media with the players. I love talking to Jeremy. He has a deeper recall than I think I gave him credit for initially, than most players really have. Like, even last night, he cited to us right away that Hunter Couture had 7 threes in the ACC championship game against him 2 years ago. And he cited that Hunter Couture had 5 threes up in Blacksburg last year. Like, that stuff, I'm not able to tell you that without going to Hunter Couture's career page and looking at what he's done against Duke. Jeremy just knows it. And there's been other times where he'll ask us for confirmation on stuff. And it's like, yep, Jeremy. Yep. You had 22 against Oral Roberts or whatever. And yeah, he's a really good one for us to talk to. He doesn't always give the longest answers. Like, sometimes you kind of got to pump him for information a little bit, but he'll hit you with some gems. And as we continue to drop segues to the Carolina game, it was last year's first Duke Carolina game that was at Cameron, where was it tied or was Duke up one when he hit flip on the roll to late and score?
I'm not exactly sure. I want to say it was tied.
Whatever that play was, Jeremy Roach told us in answering a question that he knew Carolina was going to miscommunicate and leave flip open on a roll. And I asked him how he knew that. And he said, because they weren't really talking all game. I was like, okay.
That's a high IQ play. Yeah.
All right. Thanks for that nugget. Are you telling me that there's chemistry issues on this Carolina team? Are you telling me that their defense is not exactly in sync? That was just, if I could get insight like that after every game, I'd be a happy journalist pounding out my stories for dozens of people to read.
Yeah, I mean, that's a hell of a tidbit from him. And one other guy too for Duke, Connor, that is his backcourt counterpart. That I don't know, even if Roach comes off the bench again, like, him and Proctor will be the two-headed monster for Duke. I know Caleb Foster, he started out hot for Duke. He had all 8 points within like the first 8 minutes of the game. And played about, I think he played 15, 20 minutes for the whole game, maybe 25. I'm not looking at the minutes right now. But point being, it's going to be Roach and Proctor. And I want to talk about Proctor because I know we talked about him in previous episodes about he was inconsistent and stuff. But honestly, like, looking back from me saying that earlier, it just seems like he's now not only healthy, but confident, because his first 4 games back from injury, he scored 9 points, 14, 0, and 3. He averaged 6.5 points per game in his first 4 games. And 3 of those games, he shot 3 or more free throws in 1 of 4 of those games. You know, I said if he shoots 3 or more free throws, his points per game go up. And so in his last 5 games, Connor, since that first 4-game stretch out of injury, he's averaging 16 points per game on 50% shooting, 48 from 3. He had 4 straight games shooting 3 or more free throws before not shooting one against Virginia Tech. But in that game, there was really no fouls called. Duke shot 10 free throws. Virginia Tech shot 12 as a team. So That just kind of happened with a game flow of that game. But clearly, the more he's aggressive, he's put defenders on islands back-to-back games with Clemson and against Virginia Tech. Like, I really think Duke is starting to reach another ceiling because Proctor has found his confidence. He's got his swagger back.
Yeah, I've wanted to ask him after the last couple games if he needed some games coming back from the injury to feel like he was 100% on that ankle. And as we've talked, like, knees and ankles, you can come back and you can be medically cleared and you can be ready to play. And there's going to be a mental hurdle there. And it's a matter of getting over it. And it takes everybody different amounts of time to get past that injury. So if I had to guess, I think what he'd tell you is it took him a little bit to get over it. But now that he's over it, he's confident. I think I even caught an Instagram clip from Duke's account that he was going back and forth with Ryan Young about who has more dunks this year. And Ryan Young is 2-1 on him. And he said, like, now my ankle is 100%. So it gives you an idea of just how he feels on the ankle. And I'm right there with you. Like, if Duke is going to get this version of Tyrese Proctor, like last night, along with the 12 points, I think it was 5 assists and 3 rebounds. That's the version of him that they need. They need top 20 pick Tyrese Proctor. They need the kid that oozes NBA potential, 6'5", with whatever his wingspan is. I'm sure it's probably longer than 6'5". That's the type of player that Duke needs in the last month or two of the season.
Yeah, I mean, and that's what's going to segue us now, Connor, to the Duke UNC preview that we've so been waiting for. So Duke, 16-4, travels to the Dean Dome and face off against 17-3 UNC. UNC is obviously first in the ACC at 9-0. Duke is right there behind them after a slow start. And obviously UNC is led by the favorite to win AC Player of the Year in R.J. Davis. R.J. Davis is a superstar in the ACC and then college basketball. Like, he is unbelievable. He's averaging 21 points per game, Connor. He has scored in double figures every single game this year except for game 3 against UC Riverside, where he had 8 points on 3 of 11 shooting and a 25-point win. So they didn't even need him. And he scored in double figures in 17 straight games. And, oh, by the way, in 12 of those 17 games, Connor, he has scored more than 20 points per game, including the 36 that you witnessed as you cover Wake Forest as well in the Dean Dome. So with that being said, what's your thoughts on Duke UNC?
Tyrese Proctor on him right away. I mean, I think Duke sticks with the same starting lineup. So I think Jeremy Roach keeps coming off the bench, even though you know how good he is, and you know his minutes are probably going to be more than at least Caleb Foster, maybe Jared McCain too. But I don't think John messes with something that's worked for the last two games. So that means to start the game, you're looking at put Tyrese Proctor on him, and Wake plays drop coverage on ball screens pretty exclusively. So RJ Davis was able to get to the mid-range a lot, and he's a crafty four-year guard. Like, he's can score from a lot of different places on the court, and that's what he did against Wake. His three-pointers against Wake were really in transition and off of one rotation where Wake was just late and just a bad defensive possession and with good ball movement. Man, but you said it, like, he's more explosive than I thought he was. And I really didn't think he was explosive. The first time I saw him was in 2022 when Duke went to Carolina and won that first game of the year by 20 something. The AJ Griffin went off game. I really did not think much of RJ Davis. I remember thinking that, and then I remember the game at Cameron, he had a great game, I want to say, and thinking, like, you can't let that guy beat you. Like, he's a little midget guard. What does he bring to the table?
Yeah,
and I'm not trying to crush the kid. Like,
right.
I'm trying to take you through the journey of, like,
what your thoughts were.
Man, he's so much better than I ever gave him credit for, and he's just kept getting he's kept getting better through the years to now. I mean, if you want to say the Houston guard, Jamal Shedd, is better than him, if you want to pick a UConn guard, then maybe. Is there another guard in college basketball who's better than him, though?
No, dude. I love his game. Like, it pains me that how much I love his game. He's the smoothest player in the college basketball to me. Like,
he's never out of control. He's never trying to do too much. Yeah.
The way his pace is insane. And like, looking back, obviously a year ago, seeing the most efficient player in a backcourt and the most inefficient player in the backcourt sharing the same backcourt, you wonder why you go from preseason number one to missing the tournament. That just wasn't going to work. And it clearly shows that RJ Davis was the right man to keep, because the dude just is a scorer. And he's so good. He's so crafty, man. And he's a three-level scorer, and he's special. And my key to the game, one of them, is RJ Davis will score in double figures, like I just said, but you got to make it hard on him. And you got to make him score 20 on 6 of 18 shooting. You got to turn him into a volume scorer, like a Caleb Love. Like I just said, that he was insufficient, but you got to make RJ Davis have an off game. He's going to score 20, but make it 6 of 18. You can't make it 7 of 8 where he is Blake Henson and he's just throwing a beach ball into the ocean.
Yeah, he scored 60 points in his last two games.
Yeah, he's nuts. He's nuts. And also, like, my thing, like, Duke and UNC, though, are very similar teams. Like, Roach and RJ Davis are both two really good guards that are very competitive. You know what you're going to get basically on day in and day out with a healthy Roach, and then obviously RJ Davis. And then you like Harrison Ingram, Mark Mitchell is an exciting matchup. Proctor, I don't know if Proctor or Roach would guard RJ Davis or Cadeau, but regardless, it's two talented backcourts against each other.
I think if they're both in, you'll probably – like, some of this will depend on Jeremy's health, but I would guess if Jeremy's 100%, you'll see Jeremy on Davis, and when Proctor's in the game at the same time, you'll either see him on Cadeau or Cormac Ryan. Because Cormac Ryan's got length. John could do what he did to start against Virginia Tech and put Caleb Foster on Sean Padula and have Proctor just follow Couture around ball screens. I don't think that'll be the case, but don't be surprised if it is.
It'll be interesting for sure, because those two are obviously the backcourts tell the story, but I think a sneaky matchup, not even counting Filipowski and Baycott, because this doesn't equate to them, but Harrison Ingram has 17 rebounds against Florida State. Mark Mitchell crashes the glass just as hard as he does. Obviously, he doesn't put that number up, but both those guys are high motor wings. Like, it's going to be a battle when the ball goes up.
See, your favorite player on Carolina is RJ Davis, I think it's safe to say. Yeah. Mine is Harrison Ingram. Like, that guy's motor, that guy's rebounding ability. Look, Hubert Davis has brought in four guys in the portal in his 3 years as coach to play the four in his offense or defense too. But I would say he went 1.5 and 4. Dawson Garcia was a train wreck. Pete Nance got blamed for everything that went wrong last year that wasn't Caleb Love's fault. I give you the half for Brady Manick, because I don't think of Brady Manick as having a great season. I think of Brady Manick having a good 6 weeks, a great 6 weeks.
That's fair.
But, like, he was not that for the entire season. It gets lost in translation, and it gets lost in the myth of the guy came in and hit a shitload of threes to get him to the championship game and beat Duke twice. Yes, sure. I completely agree with that, but don't pretend that he was an 18-point-a-game scorer for the entire season, and he was a liability on defense. That's why A.J. Griffin cooked his ass in the Dean Dome. But
valid.
I see Harrison Ingram as, like, oh, that's what Hubert has been looking for. Like, that's what Hubert wants that position to be. And it all makes sense. Like, that guy is a monster. He's 6'7", 235. I believe every bit of the weight and height with him. And the thing that I've already put on the message board, and I'll say this now, the one part I felt like I was really prepared to see Carolina when I went and saw them last week when they played Wake. The one thing I was not prepared for and really surprised by was they bring in Jalen Withers off the bench, the transfer from Louisville, and stick him at the four, and then they put Harrison Ingram at the three. Nobody in this league has a three that can contend with 6'7", 235. Like, you're trying to put Jared McCain on that and ask him to box out against that and defend him in the post? Like, that's silly.
But I think the one team that could do that, though, Connor, to guard that would be Duke, because Duke's found that rotation with Mitchell playing the three where you can play Ryan Young and Flip together.
It is, and that's exactly the rest of my message board post was John has played more of that combination. He's played more of either Ryan Young or Sean Stewart at the five, move Flip back to the four where he was comfortable last year, and move Mark Mitchell to the three where he was comfortable last year. I'm not saying those guys are uncomfortable now. It's different than where they were playing in November and December for the most part.
Right.
So I think we will see a lot of that lineup. I don't think you're going to see it to start. I don't think you're going to see all that much of it. But I do think when you see Ingram, Withers, and either Washington or Baycott at the five, that's when Duke is going to kind of be forced to go big. You don't ever want to say that another team's lineup forces you to do anything. You want to dictate, you know, you want to impose your lineups on the other team. I just think you're setting yourself up for failure if you try to run three guards out there when they have Harrison Ingram playing matched up against one of them.
Isn't it crazy that we're just talking about RJ Davis, Harrison Ingram, and then we're just not really talking about Baycott because he's a fifth-year senior, and I think he was preseason AC Player of the Year last season, but he just seems to have regressed. Because I was in my notes here, Connor, I have who will step up alongside RJ Davis for UNC. Because I said you'd expect fifth-year senior Amanda Baycott. He's our second leading scorer and averaging 13 and 10, but he's shooting 53%. That's not good when you realize all those touches are around the rim. And I looked at his stats from his career. This is arguably his worst season, Connor, since his freshman season, where he averaged 9.5 points per game on 47% shooting. Like, back-to-back seasons before this, he was averaging 16 and 12 or 16 and 13 and shooting in the 60s. Now he's averaging 13 and 10 and 53%. So, you know, that's just kind of – it's kind of crazy to see a guy that had such high expectations. And I know he holds the record for most rebounds at UNC, but in a weird way, it feels like he's just not really done anything this season.
It's kind of to the point where when my – guy Joe Giglio says that Efton Reed against Armando Baycott is a wash and Efton Reed might be a little better, it's not an outlandish thing to say when you consider what Efton Reed brings to Wake defensively.
Yeah, Baycott in the last two games, Connor, has scored 5 points.
I know.
Both games.
Yeah, we were talking about this yesterday in the Virginia Tech media room. David Teal is a great columnist. He just won Virginia Sports Writer of the Year for like the 15th year. I always joke with him that they're going to name that after him. Armando is from Richmond, so he's basically raised the point of, like, if you told me going into the last two games that Armando Baycott would have 5 points and Carolina would beat Wake Forest really handily and win at Florida State, I don't know if I would have believed you. And it's just kind of like, I kind of would, because that team doesn't need him to score 20 points and get 15 rebounds to win. And that's where the discussion around Armando Baycott has to kind of pivot toward when you have RJ Davis having the season he's having, when you have role definition that leads Harrison Ingram to average like 14 rebounds a game this month or whatever it is. It's insane. Cormac Ryan is really good at picking his spots and getting easy buckets because he's in his sixth year of college. Like, he was in the same recruiting class as Zion. It's not imperative for Armando Baycott to dominate games the way that sometimes he had to in the last 2 years. And I'm told, I don't know that I can sign off on having seen this firsthand, but I'm told that his defense is better this year. Told that, like, he's able to kind of affect the game in other ways rather than just dominating on the inside with points and rebounds. You know, I guess, like,
I get it. Like, I will say when we've done the previews or the last couple episodes, I've looked back at trying to compare Duke and UNC with like similar opponents. And I talked about the Clemson was cold against them. And I think it was at Pittsburgh. They were a 6-point game and then they blew, like, extended it. But their defense as a team is really good, but I don't know how much you can put on Baycott. And I get the spin zone of like, hey, he's having a bad offensive season, so let's just say he's locked in defensively also. So I can see it both ways. But both can be true. Both can be like he's regressed offensively and he has locked in more defensively because he realizes he doesn't need to score 20 and 10 a night. He can just have 7-7 for this team. But Elliot Cadeau is another guy that the last two games he had 14 against Wake and 16 against Florida State. But there's still question marks. He's averaging, I think, like 7 points or 8 points per game, to where if Duke blitzes RJ Davis on ball screens, is this a guy that can go get the bucket when it's a swing pass away? Because he's 4 of 20 from three, so Duke's going to sag off on him, and Duke's going to play him, let him shoot. And so the question for the young freshman is, can you make the shots when Duke sags off? Because Duke's going to lock in on RJ Davis.
Yeah, you're gonna use yesterday's blueprint as what Duke is going to do defensively. I think I looked at some point late in the first half, and MJ Collins had taken more shots than Padula and Kator combined. Like, it was 7 for Collins and 6 for the two of them. Duke is going to want Elliot Cadeau and Cormac Ryan and Paxson Wojcik and Seth Trimble when they're in there. Like, yeah, you guys shoot everything you want. If you make a couple, that's fine. If you make a shitload of them and beat us, we're going to be pissed, but that's fine. Like, you're playing a percentages game. And to use one of the things that John said about Virginia Tech's offense, is it's a pick your poison offense. Like, Duke can either get beat by RJ Davis or Duke can get beat by other guards. I watched Wake Forest get beat by RJ Davis the other night. Like, yeah, it's very much going to be funnel shots away from RJ Davis and make everybody else beat us. Probably not Armando. Like, you don't want to see Armando go off for 28 and 15 and foul everybody into foul trouble in the first half and have his way in there. So, yeah. It's going to be a pretty easy game plan to track when you're just looking at how many shots, who the shots have come from.
Well, so Connor, we'll close with this. What is your key to the game? Is there anything in particular that Duke needs to do to win the game in the Dean Smith Center?
I would say, I don't even want to say hold RJ Davis under any kind of points. I think it's just make him inefficient. Take away what he wants to do, and what he wants to do is score at all three levels. So it's really hard to do that. Not too many people have done it this year. Like, maybe call up the Highlanders. I looked up who UC Riverside's mascot was so that I could drop that one in there.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, ask them what they did. But no, I mean, like I said, I think on the last episode, I've seen two teams this year that I think can win the national championship, and one of them is Arizona, and I think I have to walk that back because they just keep losing games to bad Pac-12 teams. But the other is Carolina. Like, this team, the one thing I'll end on, like, their role definition is so precise, so clear. Like, nobody tries to do anything out of body. Nobody takes it upon themselves. Like, you're not going to see Seth Trimble jack up 3 threes in 2 minutes that he's in there. Like, they just know who they are. And that comes from experience. That comes from having an older team. And honestly, like, I'm not saying Duke can't win a national championship, but I think that's the part of this race where Duke has to run that through and have role definition if they want to be in, you know, I'm sure it's really important for them to be in Connor O'Neill's list of teams that can win the national championship. But I think if I see that from them in the next month, and it can start in this game, like, this is the game that you see everything through the prism of, right? Like, this is the measuring stick. If you get that in this game, then I'm going to start thinking, like, okay, you've got it. Like, you've done it. You know who drives the bus. You know where everybody needs to pick their spots and be effective.
Yep. I mean, to go off of that, I agree. Like I already said, RJ Davis, he's going to get 20, make it 6 of 18, make him work for it. Like you said, make him insufficient. And I think for Duke to go off of that, UNC is not really a good three-point shooting team. But outside of RJ Davis, I ran the numbers. They're 33% from three. So it's not a really good shooting team. So let others shoot threes. And also, I'm not even saying win the boards. You don't have to win the boards, Duke. But what Duke has to do is they have to give up no more than 12 offensive rebounds. Because if they're missing from three, Duke's got to get those defensive rebounds and make sure there is no second chance points. Make sure it's 10 or less second chance points, probably even less than that. But I'd say 10 to 12 offensive rebounds is the max you can give up, because it's a slippery slope when you start giving up 15 or more. That's not a winning recipe. And obviously the one strength Bacot has proven is he's a hell of a rebounder. We've already touched on Ingram, and then Cadeau's a good rebounding guard. So Duke's going to have to, they're going to be undersized like they've been all year besides the Virginia Tech game, but it's gang rebounding. And Jared McCain's going to have to get 10 more rebounds like he did against Virginia Tech. So
it's his second double-digit rebounding game too.
Yeah, it's crazy he didn't have a double-double. He had 9 points and 10 rebounds.
To throw one little stat in there, the seven Duke players who played at least like 10 minutes or more, and the seven Duke players who took a shot last night, five of them shot better than 50% or 50%. The two that didn't, Jared McCain had 10 rebounds, and Jeremy Roach was your team leader with 16 points, and he was 4 of 5 on threes. So he just missed at the rim and in the mid-range. If you can have that kind of offensive performance, you might be able to survive an RJ Davis 30-piece.
Oh, absolutely. It's going to – look, regardless, it's going to be a great game. Like, everything we just said is going to be out the window. Bacot's going to have 20 and 10 after I just said that he's been non-existent, and that's just how the world works, dude. It's going to be – I'm going to be cold take exposed now that we're on YouTube. This is going to be clipped, and I'm going to be in trouble. But, Connor, brother, I appreciate it. All right, this is our first episode, I will say, on YouTube, 48th episode in total. So I appreciate the reoccurring listeners. I appreciate the new viewers. And Connor, I'll see you next week, and hopefully we'll be recapping a Duke win against UNC.
Sounds good.